Beyond is a word that we use quite a bit every day. If something is absolutely incredible, you say, hey, that's beyond belief. If you can't, if you don't understand something, you might say, that's beyond me. We used to sing a song in churches back in the day. Do Lord, oh, do Lord, do remember me. Look away beyond the blue. When we like something a lot, we say, hey, that's beyond compare. When we're blown away by something that's really good or really bad, we say, that's beyond ridiculous. When I get a $5 off coupon in the mail, I go to Bed Bath & Beyond to buy boxes of K-cup coffees. That's the truth. But here's the truth about this idea of beyond. Although we say the word frequently, none of us likes to go there personally. Growth is hard. Movement in a new direction is challenging. We don't easily go to new places. So while we may like the idea of going beyond, we just don't like to be the ones to have to do it. But when you think about it, just about any kind of spiritual growth, any kind of change, any time that God is at work in us, it involves going beyond where we are now. It involves some kind of movement. It involves some kind of disturbance. It involves some discontent with the status quo before we will go beyond. Max Dupree said it best when he said, in the end, it's important to remember that we cannot become what we need to be by remaining what we are. We cannot become what we need to be by remaining what we are. There's a big word in the Bible for what God wants us to become. The process of moving us along. It's a word called sanctification. Can you say that word with me right now? Sanctification. That's a fancy way of saying this. God loves you just as you are right here, right now, in this moment. He loves you just as you are, but He loves you too much to leave you that way. He wants you to grow up. He wants you to go beyond. And so He sends His Holy Spirit to poke and prod and push and probe towards something we aren't right now, and that's to become more like Jesus Christ. Sanctification is the process that God wants to happen in our life. But we fight that. We often fight that. Why do we do that? Well, because we're lazy. We're selfish. We prefer to stay the way we are and do the things that we want to do. We don't like change. I heard about an employee who refused to sign changes to his company's pension plan policy. They were making a change with a pension plan, and they needed 100% participation, or they couldn't make the change, and only one guy held out. Only one guy was a holdout. And finally, the boss called him in one day, and he said, I need you to sign this pension plan change. He said, in fact, if you don't sign it, I'm going to fire you. You're going to lose your job. He pulled out a pen, and he signed it. He went back out in the factory, and all the buddies said, well, did you sign the change? He said, yes, I did. They said, you've been holding out on this thing for weeks. What changed your mind? He said, nobody ever explained it to me like the boss did. You see, we don't always change when we see the light, but we change when we feel the heat. Isn't that true? We don't always change when we see the light, but we change when we feel the heat. And that's almost always the way it is in our life. The way I'm living right now feels pretty good to me. I've got my problems, but changing scares me, so I'll stay right here. But I believe deep in your heart, you desire to go beyond. I believe deep in your heart you desire to allow the radical message of Jesus to confront you and disturb you into new thoughts and new actions and to a place beyond your present habits and beyond your present ruts and beyond the way your marriage is now and beyond the negative or fearful or arrogant ways that you see yourself right now, beyond the cycles of depression and discouragement that you so easily get trapped in, beyond the casual Christianity that you've been dabbling in, beyond busyness and overextending yourself that this time of year is so prevalent. Jesus is calling, follow me. Jesus is on the move, and it's time for each of us to listen, to follow Him. I pray this will be an incredibly personal journey for each of us. But I also believe that Jesus is calling us as a church to go beyond. We know that God is blessing us, and we're so thankful for that, and we can see some encouraging, healthy fruit among us right now. But I believe if we're 100% following Jesus in every way, we'd probably look a little different, and we'd probably be different in some ways than we are right now. So over the next few weeks, we're going to wrestle with what it means for us to go to places beyond as individuals and as a church. It's kind of scary, but I think it's very exciting. So let me lay out the next few weeks for you. Next week, we're going to think about what Jesus tells us in going beyond comfort zones and discover that when we go beyond our comfort zone, Jesus meets us in powerful ways to take us to places we've never gone before. By the way, how do you know you're growing? I'll tell you, one of the ways you know you're growing is you're considering attempting something you've never done before. That's one of the ways to know that you're growing. And then we're going to explore what it means to go beyond the walls, to go beyond the walls of our church buildings and our safe sanctuaries and into the streets and into the community and into the neighborhoods. Because, friends, Jesus isn't just in here. In fact, I would say he's not even primarily in here. Jesus has left the building. Jesus is on the move all around our communities. And so our love and our care needs to go beyond the walls. And then we're going to tackle the idea that when you follow Jesus, he leads us into a special community that is colorblind, but not colorless. A community that does not live by the divisions and segregation and separation that we find all around us, which is divided up by race and ethnic lines and dividing walls and partitions that can insidiously and subtly run through our own hearts. But when you follow Jesus, he leads us and he calls us to be a unique people that goes beyond racial zones. And then we're going to explore what it means to go beyond words, to how to make sure that our Christianity is not just a bunch of religious blah, blah, blah coming out of our mouths, but is a loving demonstration of a living God to the watching world. And then at our Christmas Eve under the stars, oh, this is going to be so fun. We're going to do Christmas Eve under the stars, and we're going to talk about how Jesus comes into our world, and he goes beyond expectations. That regardless of the mess our lives may be, there's no life too messed up for the Messiah to come. Isn't that cool? I love that. Beyond expectations. Some of you say, what does Christmas Eve under the stars mean? Well, let me explain it to you. This is complicated, so follow along. Christmas Eve under the stars means we're going to have one Christmas Eve service outside under the stars. Okay? Did I go too fast? We're going to have one Christmas Eve service outside under the stars, hence the name. Now, I know for some of you folks, I mean, you know, you get real excited about that. For folks who grew up in Florida or folks who've been in Florida a long time, you're thinking, man, it's going to be cold out there. We did this a couple years ago. I think it was like 59 degrees outside. I think it's 59 degrees. I had just moved here from Ohio. I'm in like a T-shirt and shorts. I mean, you know, and all the people who've lived in Florida a long time, they say, hey, Pastor, this is really cute. Can we go in the building now? Can we go in where it's warm? So I'm just preparing you for that. Christmas Eve under the stars, one Christmas Eve service at 7 o'clock on Christmas Eve. It's going to be great. And then we're going to wrap up this series, Beyond. And we're going to talk about on the final weekend that we realize Jesus is leading us to be part of something beyond us. And that's going to be the weekend that we're going to commission our brothers and sisters who are going to be extending the vision and mission of Journey Christian Church into Mount Dora. That's going to be a special service, a special time of kind of commissioning those who are going to be launching Journey Christian Church Mount Dora that last weekend of the year. I'm excited about where God's going to take us beyond right now and in the new year. And quite frankly, folks, we need to go beyond as a church. The culture around us is changing so fast. It's making our ability to relate and to connect to and to be relevant to a culture and a world increasingly difficult and daunting. And it really is a task that is beyond us. And it's easy to get discouraged about that sometimes. Did you know that about only 17% of the people in this country attend a church like this on any given weekend? About 17. Now, on Easter, it goes way up. On Christmas, it goes way up. But only about 17% on an average weekend. And if the weather is less than ideal, meaning if it rains a little bit, if it snows up north, it drops to 12%. Darren Key is the chief executive officer of a great organization in Florida called Christian Financial Resources. And he told me just this past week, I thought this was so interesting. He said right now in the state of Florida, there's 213 Christian churches who would share a common heritage and kind of common beliefs with Journey Christian Church. 213 churches like that throughout the state of Florida. That's in a state of over 19 million people. If you're quick at math, you know that's not a lot, but it gets worse. Darren said when he first started working with CFR in 1997, there were 230 churches in the state. But since 1997, 5 million more people have come to the state of Florida, and we've had a net loss of 17 churches. That's startling. But we're not just losing numbers. We're losing influence. We're losing our soul. Social researchers tell us that people who regularly go to church have the same moral behavior as their unbelieving friends. The divorce rate, pornography rate among those claiming to be Christians is just as high as those who don't. We're at risk of losing impact, as salt and light to make a difference. Too many Christians are viewed as irrelevant, missing the point of major issues and the people Jesus cares so much about. In the world's eyes, the reputation of Christians is tainted. We're thought of as a bigoted, marginal fringe group with a bunch of quirky conservatives on the peripheral who are intellectually weak and morally inconsistent. And inside the church, sometimes even our top leaders, we stop and we really wonder, are we getting the job done? I mean, many churches are floundering, and we're not sure if we're getting any traction. Are we just putting on a show here? Is this like a religious show that we come to for an hour or so on the weekend to entertain some folks? And so many people get caught up in playing the game of church, churchianity as it's sometimes called. And even the best and healthiest churches are asking, are we really making disciples of Jesus Christ? Are we really transforming lives? Are we changing the world? When Jesus said we should pray in the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, is that really happening? Friends, this is no time for business as usual. We need the power and presence that will take our lives and our churches beyond where we are right now. And let's don't ever forget this. If you feel overwhelmed by how fast culture is changing, remember this. Our goal is not to keep up with the culture. Our goal is to keep up with Christ. And if we follow Jesus and if we keep our eyes on Him and let Him shape us into what we need to be, we will make a difference. We will shape culture. We will see lives changed. And we will help others go beyond where they are right now to the real life found only in Jesus. I want to talk to you very specifically about a couple ways that God's leading Journey Church to go beyond. The first one is this, is no secret. We're going beyond a single site location to multi-site ministry. We're going beyond a single site location to multi-site ministry. If you've been around Journey for a while, you know that we feel called to launch a new campus of Journey Christian beyond this campus in Apopka, to become one church in multiple locations by taking the vision and mission and values of Journey and transplanting it into another community, specifically the Mount Dora community, but not just for Mount Dora, but all that Lake County region, in order so we might reach more people who are far from God and also far enough from this campus that they might not make the drive down here to be part of what's going on. It's a satellite campus. It's an extension campus with Journey people and programs and pastors and preaching, the whole Journey DNA, all of that makes Journey, Journey. We take that brand and I believe some of the best of the bunch of us and we start up a new work there. Now you may say, why are we doing that? Listen to me. The best way to reach unchurched people, and you can tell there's a lot, is through establishing new campuses of existing churches and to plant new churches. New churches best reach new generations, new residents, and new people groups. A higher number of younger adults have always been disproportionately found in newer congregations. New residents to communities are almost always reached better by new congregations. And new sociocultural groups in a community are always reached better by new congregations. That's just a fact. We have a great staff that's going to be led by Pastor Joel Craig, and we have some wonderful volunteer leaders. We have a committed core group of people, and who they're setting on go. And I want to ask you to pray with me that that core group of people will double over the next year. Whatever that launch team is, whatever that launch team is, if it's 100, if it's 200, if it's 50, that seed group that's going from here to there will be multiplied and expanded way beyond them. But friends, we're going further than Mount Dora. Boy, I've been kind of sitting on this information for a little while. And I'm so excited to share this with you. We're going further than Mount Dora. We're going beyond U.S. borders to help plant a church in Ecuador. Let me say that again. We're going beyond U.S. borders to help plant a church in Ecuador. We're going to partner with some highly effective mission partners, Stadia Church Planters, and Compassion International to plant a church in one of the poorest areas in Ecuador. The church planter is ready. There's an accountability network in place, and there are 200 children who are waiting, who will receive education, nutrition, spiritual training, and most of all, the gospel of Jesus Christ through the ministry of Compassion International. For every one child that participates in a Compassion sponsorship program, 28 other people are impacted. And we're going to help see that happen. Just watch and see how God's going to use this.
Broken sky, traced out by the city lights. My world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight. Touchdown in the cold black top, hold on for the sudden stop. Breathing the familiar shock of confusion and chaos. All those people go.
The only important thing that she wants for her and her family is have a good life, have a healthy life. And healthy is the most important thing for her, and that her daughter can grow up healthy.
I can't see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your eyes, Lord. Give me your eyes for everything that I keep missing. Give me your heart for the brokenhearted. Give me your heart.
In January of this year, 2013, I was in Ecuador. I was where that building that you saw there. I was a part of a group of pastors that went down and just began to get a vision of what God can do through the partnership of a local church in America, Stadia Church Planting, Church Planting Partnership, and Compassion International. And I can tell you, it is amazing. It is amazing what has happened. That area there, the poorest of the poor area, and that church facility that was built for about $85,000. $85,000 built that church facility. And the families that are being ministered to and the children that are being ministered to there. So what we've been doing is we've been setting aside some mission monies. Every month here at Journey, we've been setting aside some money. But we need some help in the Christmas offering for missions. We take a Christmas offering for missions every year, and we need to finish that project up. And so this year, our Christmas offering for missions has a twofold kind of outreach to it. I call it glocal. We're going glocal. We're going globally to Ecuador. And we're also helping support our Mount Dora campus that's going to be launched. We need to go beyond what we've ever done before in our Christmas offering for missions. Last year, our largest missions offering ever was $45,000. It was $45,000 to help put a transitional house, just as you are ministry, women coming out of prison to kind of get settled in a new routine, a new life. We raised $45,000 for that. We need to double that this year, guys. We need to double that this year to help finish up the Ecuador Church Plant Project and to help give some seed money to Journey Christian Church in Mount Dora. And I want to ask you, I'm telling you this now, we'll talk about it more over the next few weeks, but I want you to pray and prepare for that. This is a gift beyond your normal tithes, beyond your offerings. This is a special gift. Melinda and I have already decided, we've prayerfully decided, we're going to write the biggest check to Journey Christian Church that we've ever written, because we believe in what God's going to do beyond us. And I want to ask you to pray about that. to join us in that. December 21st and 22nd. I'd love for us to bring our offering here. Obviously, you can do that anytime you want, but that weekend to really make that a weekend that goes beyond. Let me switch gears for just a moment right now. I want us to look at a story very quickly in Matthew chapter 4 that kind of builds a platform for how we go beyond and what it looks like to go beyond the old life, to go beyond the past. In Matthew chapter 4, Jesus is beginning his ministry in the region of Galilee. Here's a picture of modern day Sea of Galilee. It's kind of how it looks right now. It's called the Sea of Galilee. It's more accurately a Lake of Galilee because it's about 13 miles long north to south. It's 8 miles wide east to west. Here's another picture of the Galilee Lake or Sea of Galilee. You can see how beautiful it is. It slopes right down from that hillside. This is a spot where many people believe Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount, right in this area right here. Probably standing at the bottom of the hill, natural amphitheater there. Thousands of people could gather there. And Jesus began, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." If you can let your mind's eye go back to biblical times, there are 9 cities and villages that kind of ring around this shoreline here. And in those 9 cities and villages, there would have been many boats. There would have been hundreds of boats, maybe thousands of boats and many, many fishermen there. On our here's another stretch of shoreline. This is right outside the village of Capernaum. Capernaum is the little village, the little town where became Jesus' like adopted hometown. He spent a lot of time in Capernaum. The Apostle Peter lived with his family there. So probably not very far from the place where Jesus one day walked and first met Peter and Andrew. And they probably were listening to him teach for some time. On our first trip, to Israel. My wife and I, on our first trip, they showed us the kind of nets they would have used in those days. Here's a picture of what a modern-day Israeli fisherman casting out the net would look like. Now, it's very similar to the net that you see up on the platform here right now, only those nets in Jesus' time would have been made of rope fiber. This is made of nylon. And instead of stones being the anchor weight around the perimeter, these are obviously some kind of metal sinker on that, all right? So these would be about 9 foot long. That's heavy, by the way. Same kind of net that Peter and Andrew are fiddling with one day on the shoreline, doing what they do, washing, tying up the nets, mending the nets, rinsing them off, rinsing the fish guts off of them. And then here's what we read in Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, called Peter, his brother Andrew. They were casting a net like this into the lake, for they were fishermen. They'd probably heard Jesus talk before. Perhaps they'd had a conversation with him. They knew about him. But in this defining moment in their life, he calls them to throw their lot in with him, hook, line, and sinker. We kind of missed that. All right. Matthew 4:19. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will teach you to fish for people. And then we read these words. At once they left their nets and followed him. At once they left their nets and followed him. True story. Several months ago, I was getting here on Sunday morning, and 2 guys were fishing in the little pond. We have a little retention pond on the other side of our office building here, and 2 guys were out there fishing. And so I just walked over to them, and I said, "Men, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And then I just turned around and went in the office. I thought it was funny. I think the one guy looked at the other and said, "Who was that? What was that about?" What jumps out at me is that last line. At once they left their nets and followed him. These are fishermen. I mean, this is what they know. It's their livelihood, their comfort zone, their income, their social web. It's their habit. It's their hobby. It's their hangout. But Jesus said, "Follow me." And when he did that, it meant literally walking away from their moderately secure lives and following after him. It meant leaving where they were. It meant going beyond their old life, understanding they couldn't drag these nets along with them. And so they dropped them. They just dropped them. Jesus barged into the routine with an intrusive invitation. They're there at the water's edge in that comfortable place with the security of routine and faces that they knew. The smell of the water and the bait, the sound of familiar voices, the morning mist, the waves lapping at their robes. The nets felt comfortable, normal in their hands. But they heard Jesus say, "Follow me." And they knew they couldn't do that if they held on to the net. And so they had to drop the nets, and they did. Check out verse 21. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in the boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. And Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed. These guys put it all on the line. They left their boat, which usually represented a lifetime worth of saving. To have a fishing boat meant you didn't just have an occupation. It meant you were a small business owner. But even more shocking, they left their father. They went against the social norms of that day. They put Jesus before family honor. They followed Jesus, and they left their dad, literally, holding the nets. And while this next scene did not happen on the Sea of Galilee, it's not about a fishing context, but we read about another similar intrusive, interrupting encounter Jesus had with a guy named Levi. After this, Jesus went out and saw a tax collector by the name of Levi sitting at his tax booth. "Follow me," Jesus said to him. And Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. Here's a couple of observations real quick about these passages. Number one, if you want to go beyond, you got to be willing to leave some things behind. If you want to go beyond, you got to be willing to leave some things behind. That's what a wise spiritual director meant when he said spiritual growth is marked more by subtraction than addition. My faithfulness and ability to follow Jesus isn't always measured by the new things I add to my schedule or that I begin to do for Jesus. Many times it begins with the things that I cut out of my life and let go of. Because here's the truth, friends. Every following is also a leaving. Every following is also a leaving. That's what Jesus meant when he said whoever wanted to come after him would have to deny themselves and take up their cross. If you try to save your life, Jesus said, if you try to hold on to everything that you value so dearly, you're going to end up losing it. But if you're ready to lose your life for Jesus, if you drop the net, you'll find the best life of all. And that's when Jesus can lead us beyond. But it won't happen until we're willing to literally drop the nets, to leave something behind. As long as you hang on to your nets, you won't go beyond where you are right now. So let me ask you this question. What is your net? Let's define this more specifically. A net is anything that inhibits or prohibits your all-out, fully devoted followership of Jesus. A net is anything that inhibits or prohibits your all-out, fully devoted followership of Jesus. When Jesus comes and gives that call to you to sell out, to follow him completely, non-negotiable, uncompromising, what holds you back? What's in your hands that inhibits you and prohibits you from following? Jesus extends his hand and he says, come and follow me. But you've got to let go of your net before you can clasp his hand and move forward. You know, there's an old African legend. There's an old African legend that says it's easier to catch a monkey than you think. All you have to do is put peanuts in a hollowed out coconut shell and put an opening in the coconut shell just big enough for the monkey to get his hand in, but not large enough for him to extract it with a handful of peanuts. And the monkey will not let go of those peanuts. He will pull and he'll pull and he'll pull, but he will not release what he prizes so dearly and he's easily captured. And that's exactly how it works with Jesus, friends. He says right now, take my hand, but we've got so much stuff, so many distractions, so many other pursuits that draws from our heart, our mind, our soul, and our strength, so much stuff, we can't take his hand and go beyond. So again, what are the nets that clutter your hands? Did everybody get a little piece of netting when you walked in today? Did you get one little piece of netting? If you didn't, you can get one on the way out. I just want you to look at that for just a moment. This net represents what prohibits and inhibits us from moving forward to fully following Jesus. For some of us, this little square piece of net here, for some of us, our net is our stuff. I mean our material stuff. The things that Jesus said in Matthew 7 that moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. Friends, you know as well as I do, we live in a culture that celebrates the value of the stuff that moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. But Jesus Christ comes along and he says, listen, a man's life does not consist of the abundance of his possessions. Jesus says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose or forfeit his soul? This is an area, our stuff, where some of us need to go beyond, especially as we enter into this Christmas shopping season. Maybe your net is someone. Maybe this little square represents someone. It could be someone you like a lot. Hanging around them brings you a sense of security and happiness. You No, however, if you become a fully devoted follower of Jesus, you'll be led to values and convictions and principles in your life that will set a distance between you and this person. But you don't want to disown them. You don't want to forsake them. You don't want to completely kick them to the curb. But you know that becoming a follower of Christ, it means you're going to need to set some distance between you and them because you're so caught up in that net. You can hear Jesus say, drop the net, free your hands and follow me. Or maybe it's someone, this little net represents someone, but it's on the opposite side. It's someone you don't like. It's someone you hate. Someone who gets under your skin so much that they arouse all kinds of negative attitudes and vengeful thoughts and snide remarks and ungracious wishes that are cancer to the followers of Jesus. These are people, you know, there are people in our life we like to blame for our life. There are people that we like to feel bitter against and we feel justified. Do you have any idea what they did to me? They used me, they abused me, they violated me, they walked all over me, and I'm deeply hurt. And you have people around you who egg you on, who cheer you on in that right to be bitter and enraged. But friends, that is a net that will not only tangle up your hands, but your feet and your heart and your mouth and your whole life, and you'll be continually stuck in the past. If that's where you are right now, I hope that by the Spirit's prompting, you'll let that net go and you'll go beyond. You'll go beyond that bitterness and rage and let Jesus bring forgiveness and reconciliation. Maybe your net is your plans, your carefully designed, strategically well laid out plans for your life, your job, your family, your children, your grandchildren. All those plans need to be surrendered to Jesus Christ. You know, there were people who encountered Jesus as he walked around areas like the Galilee region. And they said, yes, Lord, I want to follow you, but first I've got to go bury my dad. Yes, I'm going to come to the banquet, but I'm just taking a wife. I've got to tend to some other business. I've got to complete some other things. But Jesus said, drop the net. You got a new plan now, and that plan is to follow me. I'll help you deal with the rest, but you start in right now. You seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and you follow me. Maybe your net is a net of fear. Something you're afraid of about the future. What will people think? What will people say? What will people do? Or maybe you fear that if you follow Jesus, he's going to take you someplace that you have never been before or you can't control. And then what are you going to do? That's scary. And your fear is a net. I like surprising people. I always have. In a good way. I like surprising people in a good way. I did scare my mother once really bad. I never did it again, okay? But I like surprising people. Especially my family. And there were times when my kids were smaller. I'd come home and I'd just announce, hey, guess what? We're going on a little adventure tonight. We're going to take an adventure. We're going to do something that you didn't know about. And maybe we went to play miniature golf. Maybe we went to a park and played. Maybe we went to a favorite restaurant. You know what? I don't ever remember my kids stressing out and worrying and asking me for an itinerary of our evening. Well, my oldest daughter kind of did. She was a little stressed out about stuff like that. But I don't remember my kids really saying, oh, Daddy, please tell us exactly what you're going to do with us. No, they laughed and they giggled and they squealed with excitement. Why were they excited and not afraid? Not because they knew where they were going, but because they trusted who was taking them there. And when Jesus says, follow me, he will lead you beyond where you are right now. You don't know exactly where he's taking you, but you do know who is leading you, and you can trust him. So you can drop the net of fear. Friends, we don't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. So we have to let go of that desire to be in complete control and scenario plan for every conceivable outcome and realize that being a Christian, being a follower of Jesus, is not just about getting into heaven when we die. It's about getting heaven into us while we're living right here, right now. And it's about learning this great truth. There is joy in the journey, not because we know where we're going, but because we trust who is leading us. We trust who's leading us. So we drop the net of fear. I believe every person hearing me now has a net in their hands that needs to be dropped in order to follow Jesus more fully. What's your net? What are you holding on to? Just think about that. Let that little square piece of net remind you to represent your old life. Jesus is calling you to go beyond that net. To drop that net of damaging relationships, that net of fear, of material possessions, of bitterness, and trust Jesus And know that all the security and safety and comfort of that old net is no comparison to the new life that he can take you to. Friend, let him change you. Let him take you beyond. Can you imagine? Can you imagine if Peter and Andrew and James and John had said no to Jesus? Can you imagine if they just kind of stood there and Jesus clearly said to them, follow me, and they wistfully stand there and their fingers clutch the net even more. This is my life. This is my family. This is my security. This is my retirement. Whatever this is. And they just didn't let go. And Jesus finally moved on down the shoreline. Can you imagine what they would have missed? Can you imagine what you and I would miss as we nervously and fearfully cling to the nets and we stick with the boat and Jesus passes on? You were created and you've been called to go beyond. If you really follow Jesus, here's what it will mean. It will mean your life will change. Our vision as a church is to develop a growing community of people on a life-changing journey with Jesus. That means we will be different than we are right now. That means we keep taking the next step and the next step and the next step to follow Jesus. Because friends, Jesus is on the move. And that will happen for two reasons. Because you'll add some things like daily obedience and the love of God that is beyond reason. But it means you subtract some things because you're going to drop the nets. Hebrews chapter 12, paraphrase, says, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and trailblazer and model of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and finally sat down victorious at the right hand of the throne of God. So I want to encourage you this morning to take that little piece of net as a reminder of the nets in your life that you're laying down in order to follow Jesus. And if you're courageous enough or bold enough, would you pray a prayer like I'm going to lead you in right now? Would you stand with me right now? The prayer will be on the screen. Stand with me. And I want to read this prayer to you. Dear God, disturb me. Rouse me from sleepy paths of comfortable faith that too easily become dangerous ruts of safety rather than a pathway I walk with you in a kind of adventure. Forgive me for focusing more on what I want you to do for my ministry than what you may want me to do for your kingdom. Help me to remember that your call is simply to follow and that you are on the move always. Push me with the lifting power of your spirit past the stagnant places I've been. Prod me past the horizons formed by my timidity and fear. Give me an attitude that is finally ready to follow Jesus no matter what. I want to go beyond. I really do, Lord Jesus. Where you lead me, I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. And we all agreed and said, amen.